There they are, folks, the trumpets of the morning. It's got to make you feel good.
Bit of energy on a Wednesday.
Gotta love the third sip of coffee in the morning. the first sip of the third cup of coffee, I think I should say.
Yeah, I was just gonna say, are you sure? I know what time it is for you and how much coffee you
need. I had to practice and practice to figure out what your acronym meant. And since I'm not a coffee drinker, I still can't figure it out.
Well, we simplify things. We just call it idiotic because that's our general behavior anyway. It's our charm, I think, perhaps.
How long you guys been doing this?
Almost 3 years ago now. 3 years ago we started now. We're 120 episodes, something like that. Good morning to everybody joining us. An awesome group of folks. I see lots of weather reports in the chat already. Gang, this morning we have with us Dr. David Merrill. If you haven't heard of him before, I'll give him a chance to introduce himself to you. That said, we acknowledge that he is one of the preeminent scholars in our space, and as Brent referred to, I think, in his promo tweets earlier, the learning legend, Dr. David Merrill, who has suggested that we can call him Dave because we're on a conversational level here today. So, Dave, give us an introduction to yourself.
Well, I'm old. I live in St. George, Utah. You're getting a little bit of St. George morning coming in through my window. I'm retired from Utah State University. I'm a professor emeritus, and I retired almost 20 years ago. I can't even believe that. I received my PhD before most of you were born, back in 1964. I've been a professor since that time at a number of different universities. My last one was at Utah State. I tried to retire in 2000 and whatever it was when I was 65, and I lost the instruction manual. And so I've continued to write and to lecture and to consult and do other things. I'm not quite as involved as I was. The thing I miss most is I don't have a bunch of students every day coming into my office and talking to me, and the biggest problem is that when I need a computer problem answered, I turn around, there's no one there, and that's the most difficult part of all. Otherwise, I'm a happy person. I've married to a wonderful woman, and I married her just about the time that I retired. My first wife passed away. I have six children. And I keep hold on to this number now. I have 28 grandchildren, and I have 33 great grandchildren, with two more on the way that I know of, and a granddaughter that just sent me a note that she's getting married. So it just keeps growing. So that's the most important part of me. I think another thing we may get into later. As part of being retired and being locked up during the pandemic, I wrote a second version of my book on first principles of instruction, which is available either on Amazon or directly from AECT. I don't know if those of you familiar with the first book, this one's a little bit more straightforward and simpler. And I tried to write a more straightforward kind of book. So if you want to know more, I encourage you to go there. Other than that, ask me a question.
Well, a thought occurred to me as you talked about losing the manual for retirement. You were probably caught in that transition from documentation to e-learning, and nobody sent you the link to your course on retirement in the LMS. They just forgot to sign you up in that time frame.
I joined e-learning quite a bit earlier than that because I keep talking about e to the third power learning, E3 learning. And the reason I did that is because I said I didn't like the word E. I didn't like the letter E being electronic. I wanted it to mean something more meaningful. So I said it should mean effective, efficient, and engaging. And so then I said, okay, that's E to the third. So, yeah, That was a good segue in, Chris. Thanks.
Yeah, you know, we're always looking for these ways to keep things rolling here, for sure. So as you mentioned, you've got a new edition of your book on first principles. Maybe we'll just like jump straight into that, because one of the things that we find a lot when we're talking to folks in our industry is so many of us come into what we're doing as trainers or instructional designers, we come in through a side door. Very often we start actually doing the role before we end up going back and realizing that we need formal education. We need to know more about this in order to do a good job. And these first principles are so key. And not always obvious to people who are, you know, taking the side door access or the apprenticeship model into it.
I find two things. I think people sometimes read the principles and they think they know them, but when it comes to implementing them, I've had several occasions where people say, "Oh, I really love your principles," and if you look at this course for me, I look at the course and I said, "Where are the principles?" You know, because the biggest problem with first principles is the implementation. Principles are very, very general and can apply to a lot of things. I talk about principles, programs, and practices. Programs are what you do with the principle to actually, and practices is the course you've developed as a result of it. So these are three levels of abstraction, and principles are the most general. So they apply in lots of different ways. So what I've tried to do in the first book and in this book and in many of my lectures is to say, how do we implement those principles? And so for those that are not familiar, maybe we'll just go here and share the screen and see if that works. And
perfect.
And I assume that people can see that screen.
Yep, it's come up now for sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you got it. Now it's up in front of me and I can't see you guys. How do I move this around? Okay. This is the statement of the principles. I'm not going to read them for you. You can read them. There are five principles. I've organized them here in a way that I think there's kind of a hierarchy. If you can only do one thing, start with a demonstration. Show me. If you can do more, then get some application. And application doesn't mean remember what I told you. It means do something. My whole approach is that we sometimes start with behavioral objectives. And I say that, no, I want to start with a problem you're going to solve. I want you to start your course with, what's the problem? Show me the problem that I'm going to be able to solve when I get through with your course. And then let's go inside and dig deep and figure out how do I solve that problem. And so problem solving is kind of the key. And then there are two other principles. Activation is the notion of starting with something that you already know instead of just jumping in. Too often we don't connect it with our existing mental models. And so the whole idea of activation is the hook up to the mental models that you already have. And then finally, integration. Most instruction is no good if you drop it and you're done right at the end of the course. You know, you pass the test at the end of the course and then you go back and you get on the job and your colleague says to you, let me show you how you really do this job. I know you had the course, but and so I think the big challenge is to get it outside beyond the course into the real world. So those are the principles. I don't want to make this into a lecture, but I can show you a couple of other things here if I can figure out how to do this now. Maybe right here. No, let's see. Oh, I don't know how to make my PowerPoint work when I'm not. Oh, there we go.
There you go.
Oh, wait, just took a minute. Okay. So as I indicated, implementation is the most important part about implementing these principles. And so a long time ago when I was in graduate school, I have to tell you this story. A long time ago when I was in graduate school, B.F. Skinner came to talk to us. And we all went to see the great man. And I don't remember what he talked about, except at the end of his lecture, somebody asked him a question. They said, Dr. Skinner, in your book, such and such, you said blah, 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 blah. But tonight you said blah, blah, blah. And it seems to be a disagreement. And Skinner says, hell, you think I believe everything I ever wrote? Well, for me, as a naive young guy from Farmington, Utah, finding myself in the big world of graduate school, I thought, oh, wow, that's an insight. And I've always sort of believed everything I ever read. And of course, nowadays you're in big trouble if you do that. But the thing he said next really changed my life. He said, what I've tried to do is take just a few assumptions and see how much learning I can explain with those few assumptions. And I thought, oh my gosh. My dad, when I was a kid, was an artist. He was an artist until he passed away, and a landscape painter. And I always wanted the giant box of crayons as a little kid. Every time I had a birthday, I said, I want a big box of crayons. And he'd always give me 8 crayons. Every time he'd give me a box of 8 crayons. And then when he'd sit down with me and he said, you only need 3 crayons, red, yellow, and blue. And then he would show me how you could mix the colors. And he'd draw these wonderful crayon landscapes with 3 crayons. Well, I learned from that you can do really wonderful things with just a few elements. And so when I heard Skinner say that, I said, oh my gosh. Psychology is 3 crayons too. That's what he's tried to do. And then I decided at that point in time, I would like to build an instructional theory that also is only 3 crayons. That's also just a few things. And so I concluded that you can handle almost all instruction with these 4 instructional events: tell, ask, show, and do. And it probably seems obvious, but most of what we see in the world is tell, ask. It's tell, ask instruction, you know, multiple choice, remember, true, false. Even essay questions tend to be remember what you just read. But it seems to me the things that get neglected most are show and do. Now I want to go one more step, if I can figure out how to move this to the next one again. Let's try this again. Okay. Aha. Okay, in addition to just 3 crayons for instructional events, I said, I want these instructions. There's only a few kinds of skills. Everybody says write objectives first. And I said, there's only 6 objectives anyway. And so, you know, you can write a formula and fill them in. But these are the 6 different kinds of skill that I think are required in instruction. Remember associations, identify parts, classify concepts, execute procedures, comprehend processes, and solve problems. And so it seems to me that almost all instruction can be characterized as combinations of these 3 types of skill. And problem solving down at the bottom really requires all of the skills. And I don't know that I did the next thing. I didn't. Okay. Problem solving really requires all of these skills. And so that's kind of basic essence I want to say. And from there, let's just ask me questions.
Indeed. We've got a few folks in our chat or in the idiotic community are folks that have come into instructional design from the education world, either being teachers and they're moving into that space, or they're actually currently instructors teaching their students your first principles. And I got a question from one of those teachers, and I wanted to make sure that I squeezed in her question because I thought it was a good one, actually. And now as I hem and haw on this, I'm going to try to pull it up and make sure I don't butcher her question. So here's what she does. She says, we have a series of e-learning modules that we have the learners take, and then they say which of Merrill's first principles are being identified. In her mind, they build on each other, but sometimes she gets feedback that some of the principles are out of sequence, and she's wondering if that's an accurate representation of how it all works. For example, a module could be demonstration and activation, but none of the others?
Yeah, okay, and I talk about levels of instruction. And so I would, at the beginning, I would say level 0 is the typical tell, ask instruction, you know, remember what I told you. The first level is to include demonstration or show me. And I'm absolutely astounded how often we do not show things. The best teachers in the world are kindergarten teachers because they start with illiterate students. And so they are very good at showing and telling and getting people involved. But the further we go up the educational ladder, the less and less we show. And we assume people know lots that they don't. And so show me is the first thing. And if you don't do anything else and you add show me, your instruction is going to be better. It's even better if you say, if you add application and say, do it, do something. And again, I use the word do and contrast it with ask, because do doesn't mean to just remember what you were told. Do means classify a concept, execute a procedure, solve a problem. Doing is what you have to do. And then beyond that, if you can get to a problem-centered approach, and in problem-centered, I really involve, I always say, start with, show me the problem you're going to be able to solve when I get done with this course. Show me the problem I'm going to be able to solve. And then show me, you know, get it, dig inside, dig down and show me how you do those, the various things you just showed me in solving that problem. And so you kind of work from the whole problem and then show them how to do it. And then furthermore, one other thing we talk about is having a progression of problems. That is, instead of just one problem, too often we get a course or a piece of instruction, they show us how to solve one problem. But in the real world, there's a class of problems, all kinds of variations that occur in those problems. And so if you want transfer, if you want people to use this skill that you just taught them, you need to show them a sequence of problems. And if that sequence goes from simple to more complex, that's a better way to go. Then if once you get those things down, or I guess even from the beginning, which the activation and the integration principle can be always added, and they always add a little bit. But activation without anything else doesn't really help. And integration certainly isn't going to take place unless you've learned to do some problem solving. So those are things that can enhance the instruction as well. So yes, much instruction only involves one or two of these principles. Sometimes you see application without demonstration. You see, you know, do it without show me. Sometimes we go from ask directly to a problem-solving situation, and I would always argue that that's when you get in that situation where you get on the job and your colleague says, I know you finished your school, but let me show you how you really do this task. And so I hope that answers the question. I think that was a very good question. Thank you.
Yeah, and Emily, do you have a follow-up question on that? You want to drop into the chat? Feel free to. I think there was one other part she asked me, and I think you may have already covered it. Did he cover the other question for you too, Emily? Or I think there was a second part to the question. Also having a hard time understanding the difference between application and activation. Can we get some clarity around that?
Yeah, absolutely. Activation, all of us carry around in our head mental models about how the world works. And when we learn something new, we usually search through our memory. I'm being a little bit anthropomorphic here about how it really works, but we search through our memory and we find a model that looks like what we're encountering, and we try to use that. And then we expand that model to try to accommodate whatever it is that's in front of us. Sometimes those models that we call up are very good and they allow us to really move forward. And sometimes we call up an inappropriate mental model, and then we really get misconceptions, and later on we're always screwed up over what's happening in this. So the idea of activation is, can we help the student either develop an appropriate structure to look at the new thing, or help them recall an experience or experiences or skills that they already have that we can build upon? And so that's the whole idea of activation. Application, on the other hand, is showing people how to do it. You know, let me tell you how to do it, then let me show you how to do it. Because showing is extremely important in modeling. I am going to model what you do. And so let me show you and demonstrate for you. And so it's either demonstrating the problem solving, or I might be demonstrating examples from how to classify something, or I might be demonstrating steps in a procedure. But demonstration is very, very important in show me. So I think there's a difference. In one case, I'm trying to bring what I already know to the situation. In the next case, I'm trying to show you examples of the thing that you're going to try to learn. Good question. Thank you.
Yeah, and that was a question in advance from one of our friends, Emily, who had emailed that in. We do have some questions in the question panel too. Jim has a question. You know, how do you sell? And he's putting sell in quotes and also disclaiming that it's not the right word, but how do we bring this forward into our own organizations? In particular, in his case, he's saying to the subject matter experts who, you know, there's that classic, here's the PowerPoint or here's the documentation, teach this. And we're like, well, yeah, but.
Death by PowerPoint.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm really good instructional designer. I think I can help people teach almost anything if they know how to teach it. I always tell people, I know how to teach anything, but I don't know anything to teach. but on the other hand, I am not a very good psychologist. I'm not a very good sociologist. I had opportunities throughout my career to be a department chairman. I did it a couple of times and then decided that dealing with other people is not my forte. So I'm disclaiming that I don't really know the answer to that. I know that what you're saying, what I always talk about designers by assignment. You know, last week I was the accountant, and this week I'm in training. And obviously you can teach accounting because you're an accountant, or obviously you can teach how to assemble this machine because you've done it. And that's not always the case. The universities are full of absolutely wonderful scholars who know their subject matter field in extremely great detail. And too many of them are really terrible teachers. They do not know how to put that across. And the very fact that they're very skilled is one of the very reasons that it makes hard to put across, because they make all kinds of assumptions because they forget how much they had to go through to get to where they are. And so they jump right into the end. We jump right into problem solving without any prerequisites. There isn't time in this little discussion to go into that, to problem solving, but I really encourage you to take a look at my old book, First Principles of Instruction, which is available on Amazon or directly from the Association for Educational Communications and Technology. And what I talk about in problem solving is how do you I've lost my train of thought here. How do you get to where you want to be, you know, and how do, so anyway, ask me another question. I got lost.
No worries. Well, I think just to sort of circle back to Jim's question about convincing people, we could actually perhaps leverage a bit of the activation aspect of things ourselves by SMEs are coming to us. They've already experienced being educated. We've all been through school. We know what school and teaching we feel, you know, looks like, but that doesn't always necessarily mean that we were able to experience a good model. So maybe if you got an opportunity to start a conversation by saying, okay, do you remember a few times when you really, really felt like successful as a learner? Well, let's go in that direction. Yep. And you know, might give you a bit of an emotional connection that way, you know, to help people move their thinking.
And if nothing else, I think show me, I probably wrote show me on more student papers than any other thing I ever wrote, because people just have a tendency to talk or to tell, and they don't have a very good ability to show. So I think sometimes when I'm dealing with subject matter experts, or some of my colleagues and students have, we just, instead of they start to tell you what what they think you need to teach. And what I tell them is you say, show me how you do this. Mm-hmm. And I had one instructional designer woman at work for me, very, very smart lady. And we were dealing with, telecommunications, and I think they were trying to teach how to install different kinds of telephone switches or something of that sort. I don't remember the details, but anyway, she knew nothing about this area. She says, "Dr. Merrill, I can't do this instruction. I don't even know what they're talking about." And I said, "Take so and so with you as a video camera, and you go in there and you find a guy that knows how to do this, and say, show me how you do this, and then then turn on that camera and don't turn it off. Watch everything that he does, record everything that he says. And when he's got it all done and showed how you do it, then you say to him, could you show me one more time with a different switch?" and oftentimes they say, "Well, I already showed you." And she said, "Well, please just show me one more time." And I said, "Then film that." And I said, then with those two things, or even three, if you can do it, you can come back and you can figure out what you need to teach, because they probably can't tell you, but you can observe what they're doing and what they say, and especially if you've got them to talk out loud while doing it. So that's one strategy that you can use to help people realize. And if you're in your mind, you're thinking, I've got a tell, show, and I got them to do it, then that helps to kind of pull it out. If you don't remember anything else about today's discussion, if you can remember tell, show, do, always have tell, show, do. And by do, I don't mean remember, I mean do it. Your instruction will improve. And if you can just get that far with your designers by assignment, you've made a lot of progress.
I'd just like to say right now, thank you so much for saying that about video in the SMEs. I've been saying that same thing for years, and I get a lot of eye rolls at me, you know, like, why do we have to do that? And I think I take it one step further, though, and I tell people, you know, sometimes you can use that video in your e-learning.
Oh, yeah.
You slice it up, right? I mean, it's not just for, it could be just for you as an instructional designer to figure out how to.
It might be the show me in the instruction that I create. In fact, we always ended up using it as the show me in the instruction that I create, you know, and they didn't realize that they were creating the instruction right in front of me.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's perfect. And I think the reason why I want to emphasize that point is there are a lot of folks that I've encountered in our industry that feel like when we talk about video, that it needs to be perfect, that there has to be some sort of professional quality to it. And it has to be a production with all sorts of money and there's finance. And I'm like, no, you just pull out your iPhone, point it at the expert and just capture everything that they're talking about. And
you got it.
And one, you've got it all on video. And two, you don't have to bother them again, because one of the biggest problems we have is how do we get access to SMEs? Because they're busy people.
Absolutely. Right? Absolutely.
So yep. Now you don't have to go back because you've caught it all on video. And if you need to refresh your own memory, you just go watch the video again that you just took of the conversation you had with them.
Mm-hmm. And
I've often said, this is just kind of acknowledging the question, I've often said that the greatest problem we have as instructional designers is that everybody's a teacher or everybody's an instructor. In industry and even in education, we assume if somebody knows something, they know how to teach. And that is, I think, one of the biggest challenges we have is to help people overcome that misunderstanding that if they know it, they can teach you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Speaking of tech, you know, we started talking about video. There is a lot of conversation in our industry these days about a lot of different types of tech. And I don't mean to distract us from the first principles, but actually I want us to apply your first principles to technology. So people talk about a lot about artificial intelligence and chatbots and virtual reality, augmented reality, all that kind of stuff. How do you see, the application of those things? I mean, again, it kind of seems kind of obvious, right? Like if you can show somebody how to do something in a virtual environment that you can't show them in the real world because it's too expensive, then VR is fantastic. But it may not be for everything, right? And so coming up with those decisions, do you ever have people ask you to help them choose a media, and go through that process?
Yeah. I think one of the first books I ever worked on was with a colleague of mine, Erwin Goodman, many, many, many years ago, more than 50 years ago. It was called Selecting Instructional Strategies in Media. And that's when I was just starting to worry about instructional strategies. And we actually wrote this book under contract with, I can't remember who contract. Anyway, at AECT, they had a big meeting. I remember in Salishan, Oregon, which was a beautiful place, and they had all these people, and the whole meeting for 3 days was to critique our book. And so they had all these little groups, and we would wander around, listen to other groups. And I thought, and I'm young. I mean, I was really young in those days. And I thought, oh, this is really scary. And so at the very end, they said, all right, from what we've done, what we've discussed, we would like you to kind of summarize here at the end. What now that you've decided is the real model for selecting media and how to do it? And having listened all for these 3 days, I went to the microphone and I said, all right, let me just use this a little scenario. I'm just going to be like I'm in a school. And I know I have a media closet. That closet has projectors and other kinds of things in it. This was long before we had VI and all this other stuff we have now. But it's the same idea. I just go to the closet, put a blindfold on, reach in and grab something, and I'll show you how to use it. And so, yes, technology is fantastic. You can do all kinds of things that you couldn't do with other things. But the important thing is, if you do not have appropriate tell, show, do, underneath that, that's all it can do. I mean, I'm back to my three crayons. It's all you can do is tell, show, or do, or ask. And I always say show, tell, show, do, because everybody asks. So I don't want to just remember. I want you to be able to do it. And if I can use this piece of virtual reality to get you to see it better, to show you better, great. You know, if it costs me a fortune and it's just as good as my doing it on PowerPoint, then why spend the money? And so, you know, how can I best show? Now, there's a lot of things that video is a wonderful thing because, you know, if I'm talking about interactions, video show is really hard to do that in a textbook. I think one of the frustrations I had in writing my textbook was I have a lot of interactive instruction I've explained. And so I did that with a diagram at the top and the dialogue down below. Well, it violates one of the very rules I also include in the book, and that is you can't read and look at the same time. And so you need to listen and look at the same time. And then it's in a book and it's not doing that. And I'm saying I'm violating the very thing I'm trying to teach you how to do. So it seems to me that I love the toys. I mean, this is fun, you know. I'm always good at all of them, but I think I love the toys. But I always remember I'm going to tell, show, I'm going to have them do it. Does this toy allow me to have them do it? You know, if I can't do it in the real world, how can I simulate it? Will this simulate it closely? You know, how close can I get? And again, you tell me what you've got and I'll tell you how to simulate it. I'll tell you one story. I had students do things in PowerPoint, which is a much more powerful tool than most people think. And so I said, I want you to use PowerPoint so that I can see what you actually did in your instruction. I can't see it if you do it live or if you're, you know, preparing a teacher outline or something. I want you to actually create a self-instructional piece in PowerPoint. And one of the students came to me and he said, I'm a coach. Baseball coach. I have to do it on the field. I can't do it. I said, well, okay, I'm not going to hire you then unless you do it in PowerPoint. And he said, I don't want to do it in PowerPoint. I said, I know. And I said, it probably won't be as good in PowerPoint, but I want you to force yourself to make it visible, make it there. Well, he struggled. He complained. He came back to class several times moaning and telling me I'm a terrible guy. And then one day he came back and he's all smiles. He's like, got it. I figured it out. I said, okay, good. How do you do it? He said, okay, let me show you. So he put a monitor over here on a chair and then he backed up and he said, you just come back exactly this far. And he was teaching how to be a shortstop. So he says, and then you just move over here a little bit to the right of the monitor. And he says, then on the monitor, you're seeing the pitcher and the batter as if you were standing where he is. And he says, now the pitcher's going to throw the pitch. I want you to watch that pitch and then I want you to watch the batter. And that should give you clues as to how you should move, where you should drop down here. You should move to the left, move to the right. And so he says, you watch that video and then you do the appropriate move. I said, terrific. I use that story because with a little imagination, you can use almost anything you've got to do it. As long as you're keeping in your mind, I got to get them to do it as close to the real world as I can. Mm-hmm.
That is a fantastic story. I love that. I think hearing those stories, they're so good. I'd love to hear other stories. And one thing I like to ask practitioners that have been doing this for a long time when we're interviewing them is, have you ever had an instance where something failed? Like you were out there and it just didn't work. any good stories around that?
No, but it's there's one of the skills that I put up there a minute ago was comprehend process skill. And a process basically is a set of conditions that lead to some consequence, to lead to some solution or something. And one of the kinds of skills that we do's that we don't often use in instruction is troubleshooting. Now, in technical world, people are very familiar with troubleshooting, but you can troubleshoot anything. If you understand what the conditions are, and let me use an example of selling furniture. That's the example I use in my book. All right. And so the course that I looked at, they had all these steps for how to successfully sell furniture. And I looked at it and I said, yeah, but you haven't emphasized the important part of this. It isn't the steps you take. It's how the customer responds to each of those steps. And so if you look down and watch the customer, I don't care how you get there. I watch the customer. If they don't do this, this, and this, they're not going to buy. And so the whole idea of troubleshooting is, we all get outcomes that don't work. Well, then the question is, what were the conditions that led to that outcome? And let's work backwards. And which of those conditions were faulted or missing or corrupt in some way? Or do I even identify correctly what the conditions are that led to the consequence that I want? And that kind of a skill, you can do it the other way around too. I'm sure you set a conditions and predict whether you're going to get the result you want or not. But those two skills we don't do very often. We sometimes jump right into problem solving by giving them a series of steps. Here are the steps to sell furniture. Well, the steps to sell furniture are worthless if they don't produce the right kind of responses from your customer. And that's true of almost any skill you want to talk about. What are the conditions that lead there? If I don't get the condition, it doesn't matter. I can do the step, but maybe this step is not good enough to get the condition I want. And I need to be aware of that. So the first thing I need to learn is, what are the conditions I want? Can I recognize those conditions in a whole different lot of situations? And then I can say, here's the step. You better watch somebody and see if you can recognize it when the step's done right. And now we're finally at the point where we say, all right, now you try to do the step and you see if you got the condition that you wanted.
Perfect. I just noticed too, we have a whole bunch. We've sparked a lot of questions in the Q&A. Chris, does one of these interest you more than the others at all?
Well, there are two questions that are kind of, I'm going to try to merge them a little bit. Just Lee is asking, how do the levels and the structure, the first principles apply when the learning is about mindset and not necessarily actions? And a parallel question is asking, how do you do that? How do you do this stuff with something that's purely cognitive? And I think maybe both of those questions are kind of asking about, we're not really looking for necessarily a do in from this kind of perspective of what these folks are trying to do as instructors.
Good. Then I need to come back and define do again. Do doesn't mean a physical action. I mean, I use the shortstop example. I use selling furniture as an example, do could be mental processes as well. Do can be how to use a formula. Do can be how to do a computation. Those are cognitive skills. There's do identify, there's do execute, and then there's do predict or do troubleshoot. These are all different kinds of do's, but the do itself doesn't, it can be a mental do, it can be a physical do, it can be a writing do, it could be a speaking do. I mean, do can be anything. And so we always do. You're not going to learn anything if you don't do it. Now, maybe the do is a mental activity, but then I got to, if I'm an instructor, I got to get that mental activity out of their head some way. So I either got them to say something, write something, move, answer, so do is very broad, not just physical activity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe what we can do real quick here is that just ask those of you that asked the question or now after hearing his answer, maybe some others have come up with some examples. If you maybe drop something you're maybe struggling with, that's a cognitive thing that you're trying to teach or whatnot, something a little bit more specific and maybe we can help out there.
Yeah. Well, and even just circling back to the question that was being asked, if you're asking or you're trying to give people instruction in changing a mindset, you still need something demonstrable out of that. Okay, your mindset changed. How does that change your behavior in the world? How does that change how you and that's, and so there's doing right there that, that
yeah, let me give you an example. Affective objectives, you know, this is the whole idea of values, thoughts, character, all this kind of stuff. Very, very soft skills. You know, there's two issues here. One is somebody says, well, I can't really define what it is that I want them to do. And then I say, then you can't teach it. If, you know, and they say, well, if I define it, there's lots of variation. This is not certain in the world. And I said, yeah, but what you teach better be certain. You better teach them something that you know, and then teach them something else that you know, and then teach them something else that you know, with enough divergence that they start to say, oh yeah, there's more than just one thing. And so that's part of the idea of having, I use a little phrase called greater than three. When I show you how to solve problems, you better have at least three examples. And that's probably not enough, depending how complex it is. And so, yeah, you can use these soft skills. One of the examples I used one time, a teacher said, okay, they were trying to teach how to be kind in your environment and, you know, how to not litter and this kind of stuff. This is, I think, junior high or elementary school or something. And I said, okay, here's what you do. One of the first days of class, hand out individually wrapped pieces of candy to everybody in the class, and or on a field trip. This is even better on a field trip. Hand them out bags of taffy that they can unwrap, and then just kind of without saying anything, just pick up the wrappers and count how many that there are and what happened. And then I said, then later, not immediately, but later, you have your lessons on being and taking care of the environment and so forth. And then sometime later you take another field trip and you pass out candy again and see if there's see if you made any difference. If you didn't, then you know dang well that your instruction didn't work. So, you know.
Yeah, it's getting that part you were talking about at the very beginning about getting down to the practical elements of applying the principles. And, you know, in unique and creative ways, it's fantastic.
And the challenge for a designer, your subject matter expert isn't going to help you with this. You know, I'll tell you one more story. You say you like stories. Okay. Yeah. I'll tell you one more, Brent. I was working with an English professor and I said, you need to have a problem centered course. And he said, there are no problems in English. I just want people to understand these stories. And I said, well, what do you mean? Okay. I said, what do you mean by understand these stories? I want them to think creatively. And I said, I have no idea. I mean, I did, but I said, I have no idea what you're talking about. What do you mean think creatively? And he said, well, you know, most stories have a surface level and then the author had something underneath that they're trying to teach. And I want them to kind of look down. And I said, whoa, okay, give me an example. He said, well, for example, we're studying A Man for All Seasons, you know, Thomas More. I don't know if you all know that story or not, mm-hmm. but Thomas More had this terrible conflict with the king. And if he, you know, if he obeyed the king, he was violating his moral thing and so forth. He had to make this choice. It was really tough for him. And he said, so what I want them to realize is to see that this just isn't this story about this guy had a problem. This is we all have this dilemma. And I said, did you just present a problem to me? And he said, what? And I said, we're at Brigham Young University, Hawaii. We have students from 80 different countries. And one of the things they all have to do when they come here is sign a piece of paper that says, I will go home. We talked about returnability. And I said, but 60% never go home. They stay in the United States. And I said, even though they've signed that paper, and since we're a moral, you know, a church school, I'm sure that moral principles are big on them. And I'm sure they don't, you know. So I said, at the very beginning of the class sometime, have them write an essay on the returnability idea from the university, right? What do you think about it, you know? And you can do it anonymously. You know, you can code the paper so you can tie them up at the end. But you don't care who's what. Just, and then he said, then later you do this story about Thomas More. And maybe others that have a similar kind of theme. And then later you have another write an essay on returnability again and see if it changed their mind. You should be able to reflect in that where it is. That's a way to get at, you know, we're talking about internal stuff. That's a way to kind of get at that internal stuff. Now, I may not know that for any individual in that kind of a situation, but But you know, I can tell if they're getting the skill that I want, if they're getting the value that I want, they're picking that up.
It's fantastic. I love that. We got a couple more questions in there, Chris. What's the next one look like?
So Bob Kennedy is asking, what's the best way to promote learning retention?
Follow the problem-centered instruction. We were talking earlier. I don't think we talked about it with the group. E-learning. And when I saw that term e-learning, I said, electronic doesn't tell you anything. I mean, it doesn't, you know, electronic learning is terrible or good or in between or upside down or confusing. I mean, what does electronic have to do with anything about learning except as a way of delivery? And it doesn't make it better. But so I want the E to mean something else. And so I said, okay, what I've tried to do all my career is to make learning better. And so I said, let's take three E words, efficient, effective, and engaging. And let's talk about E to the third power. So how do we make it effective, efficient, and engaging to do that? And now I forgot your question, but
working on best way to improve retention. Sorry, I dropped.
Oh, okay. No, good.
I'm working from memory here.
I got carried away and then, yeah, I'm getting older. So the best way to do retention is learning is the most motivated. People ask me, why don't you have a motivation principle? And I says, because I can't say to a student, be motivated. And have it do anything, you know, and I can do stupid things like make it jet fun. And I just see an advertisement on television, drives me crazy. We know language learning is hard, so we made it fun. Yeah, well, it's probably crappy instruction. I don't even know. I just bet it is, because I see people trying to make stuff fun in the idea of motivating or making it appealing to people. And often what that does is increase the cognitive load to the point where it's very difficult. I saw a thing called Mathematics Under the Sea, based on The Little Mermaid. And I said, I guarantee you that that is not going to be as effective as even a straightforward piece of instruction, because the kids are thinking about what her name is, Little Mermaid, and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And I said, has nothing to do with the mathematics. This is ridiculous. And so if we're going to make things appealing to people, if we're going to, you know, what was the question?
Yeah.
The retention piece.
People, learning is the key to motivation. It's also the key to retention. If I gain a skill and I can do something, that becomes important. I happen to be an avid model railroader. I have my upstairs house has a huge model railroad in it, and I'm really pretty good at it. You know, I like to make it real realistic and have photographs that people can't recognize that they're models and things like that. Why did I do that? Well, somewhere back in my childhood, I came across a model railroad magazine when I was a kid, and I decided the Lionel trains weren't real and I needed something more real. And I got me into the scale model railroading. And as a kid, you know, I like to build things and models and stuff. And so the better I got at it, the more I went to associate with other people at it. And so now people look and say, oh, wow. I love it when people come to my house and they say, oh my gosh, this is fantastic. You know, it's very rewarding to me, you know. And why? Because I learned some things. All of us kind of gravitate to that place where we start find that we have some skills that we can do it. So if you want retention, then the most important thing is to make sure they get it in the first place. And how do you get it in the first place? Tell, show, do. And if you do that, they'll start to retain it. Also, activation becomes very important at this point in time. If I can build on a mental model that they already have, then they're much more likely to integrate it and to use it later on. If it's out here by itself and it's not related to what I already know, it's going to be very difficult to retain or very difficult to find it later when I need to use it.
Yeah, it's interesting. A very recent example for me is my son's taking a real estate finance class, and it's not something I've ever been interested in. I'm not a spreadsheet guy, right? And I'm not really, I do like banking and mortgages and all that kind of stuff has always driven me nuts. But as I'm going through and reading it as an adult now, and having had a couple few homes now, it's starting to get, it interests me more. But as I read all of the vernacular, all the words that they use and the phrasing for everything, it dawns on me that it's going to be exceptionally hard for somebody brand new to this world to really learn and understand this stuff from a textbook if they're not surrounded by people who talk about this stuff in that way and use those terms all the time on a regular basis. Me as an adult who understands this stuff, and I should be able to figure out how to make myself learn this, I'm going through reading the textbook going, unless I submerge myself in a room full of financial analysts, I'm not going to be able to commit this stuff to memory.
Well, yeah, and the problem is because you're probably getting tell, ask instruction, or not, or just tell, and they're not showing you, and if you're going to learn that, you know, you probably pay real attention to it if some loan company is jerking you around on your mortgage, you're going to think a little bit more about, you know, okay, wait a minute, what's the deal here, the other part about motivation is get people, it's something they're interested in. You know, I always tell you, when you think about a problem, I want to teach problem solving, or I want to teach people how to solve particular kinds of problems in my course. Then if those problems are personal, or if they're in the experience, they're much more likely to learn them. If they're very abstract, you know, I'm going to teach you how to do a balance sheet on a spreadsheet, and I don't have any reason to use that, or no problem to solve for it, or nothing in my experience about it, the best I'm going to do is memorize a bit to pass the test and I'm done. So, you know, that's the other issue is, how do I, now, if I'm in the training world, the business world, most of the time people are in a course that's sort of related, not always, but sort of related to what they're doing. And if it's related to what they're doing, and you can show them how they can do what they're doing better, more efficiently, more fun, then they're going to be motivated. They're going to be, and they're going to retain what you teach them, and they're going to pay attention. Mm-hmm. Unless you do it in a dumb way by just spraying and praying and hoping they remember.
Yeah. You know what I do? I've totally not even paid attention to the time, and we've gone way over our normal time, but this has been fantastic, and I'm so glad we were able to, this was just great.
Your coffee got cold. Is that the problem right now?
Yes, I got to get a refill. No, this is just great. And I just want to be respectful of everybody in the chat. I know everybody's probably got meetings they want to run off to at the top of the hour and whatnot. Otherwise, I'd sit here and chat with you about this stuff all day long.
So, well, I'm not going anywhere, so I'm welcome to stay as long as you want me to.
Oh, excellent. Well, and you are welcome to stay for sure, but we're going to wrap this up here. And you know what? Let's have you back, if you don't mind. Maybe we'll reconnect offline, and we'll have you back in a few months, and hopefully some of these folks in the chat will come back and maybe have implemented some of the things they've learned today, and we can do some follow up. How about that?
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. Buy the textbook, you guys.
There you go. Get out there.
I think Brent, you sure.
And by the way, I want you to know, this is not a money-making thing for me, and all of the proceeds from this textbook go to help students at AECT attend the conference.
Oh, cool. And well, so, there it is.
So, you know, when I push it, I'm not pushing it because I'm going to get wealthy, because I learned a long time ago I'm never going to be wealthy. But it does help the students at AECT. So in addition to being really excellent work, you know, it'll help students at AECT. So
fabulous.
Take them, and not only that, it might even help you.
One thing we've learned along the way is that even though there are lots of folks in our community who produce really great books. None of them have ever gotten rich from them either. So it's the nature of, I think it's the nature
of. If you want to get rich, you better write romance novels or something like
something
that.
Something else we need to do. However, the textbooks are critical to, and Brent has dropped the link in there. Folks want to follow up and look into that. Dave, Dr. Morrell, thank you so much for joining us here today. It's been fabulous. And
my pleasure.
Like Brent said, we'll look to bring you back again and maybe elaborate further on some of these things, folks. Thanks everybody so much for joining us here today. We're going to dance
Thank
on
you
out,
all that joined
we'll
us.
See everybody next week.
Okay. Indeed. Here we go. Make it a great day, everybody. Oh, I guess I should close the live stream.
Yeah, whenever you finish dancing there.
Whenever I'm feeling it. All right. I haven't done a good special effect in a while. Here we go. Here's a good zoom for
there
everybody.
There we go. Yeah.